time, but I guess I better get started with some music. And after our music, I will take roll. I'll make a couple announcements, take roll, that sort of stuff. And then we'll get back to the, oh shoot, I have closed my PowerPoint. Hold on. We'll get back to the lecture. So, music, attendance, announcements, lecture. I know you guys are excited. And this is a little loud, so enjoy.
Thank you.
All right, guys. So we have listened to a little bit of The Killers. And I'm going to make a couple of announcements and take roll, and then I'm going to start the lecture. So announcement number one, reminder that your topic is due this Friday on your policy paper, okay? And we'll talk a little bit as I'm going through this. You know, I'm going to actually use something that is a policy example, but we'll also talk about other policies. But basically, this is anything that you feel ought to be implemented, anything that you think that the federal government, and I do need for it to be the federal government, not a local policy or a state policy, what you think Congress should enact. And so your topic is due by this Friday night. Your paper itself is due 2 weeks after that. To get an idea on what we're expecting, read the requirements for the topic, for the paper itself, the policy paper, and then write your topic on that. That way we can give you a little bit of feedback on that. All right, so I am shifting over here and I'm doing attendance. I have two other announcements. One announcement is that there was a question on the exam that I had marked the wrong answer whenever I was going through and doing the key. And so that means you'll probably get a bonus couple of points on that one. There is also, as far as the exam is concerned, looks like, you know, there are a couple of people that I did not hear from, but just a couple who have not taken the exam. If you did not take the exam for some reason, please send me an email, check in with me. It has been opened for you until midnight. So, all right. And of course, you know, there will be a penalty for not taking it if you did not have an accommodation. I think that those are my only announcements. I feel like I'm missing something. Eric, if you remember, please tell me. I have attendance live right now.
I don't think we're missing anything. I think that's pretty good.
Okay. All right. So those are announcements. And so we're going to talk about Congress today, governing, and then we're going to talk about Congress representing on Wednesday. Just so you know, I think I told you guys my first political memory involved a congressional hearing. And I think the processes of Congress are fascinating. I focused on legislatures in my studies for my PhD, but my main focus is more, as it turns out, on the representation side. I love the processes, I do, but I focus more on the representation in my own work. That said, I do know a lot about Congress, so I'm happy to talk to you about it today. Let's get this started. Okay, there are two functions of Congress. As I said, on Wednesday, I will talk about representation. But today, we're talking about governing. And so the key thing with Congress is it has a very key role in our governmental structure. It is by far the most powerful institution formally, constitutionally, by law. Over time, the president has become more powerful, but that's been recent. And understand that by law, Congress still on paper has more power and can exercise that power. So what power do they have? Well, under governance, they have the power to make laws, oversee the executive, the president, tax and fund the agencies that provide services, right? So funding and setting up bureaucratic agencies, make federal courts and declare war. Remember, the president does not have power to declare war. Only Congress does. So here's kind of an example of all these formal powers. We see these in the Constitution, from lawmaking, taxation, spending money, regulating commerce, creating courts, and then declaring war, as I said. But we have the most important one that we've talked about early on in the class. Remember, we talked about the elastic clause, that necessary and proper clause. that specifically says that anything that Congress has been given the power to do, then they have the power to make all laws that are necessary and proper. In other words, that are connected to carrying out those enumerated powers. So when we talk about the right to vote, for example, Congress has the power to enforce that and make all laws associated with that. That's given to them in the Constitution. Congress has all the power necessary to enforce the ability of people to vote, okay? And so when we talk about the Voting Rights Act and things like that, Congress is deriving its powers from two places, from both the 15th Amendment and also the 19th Amendment, right? And 26th Amendment, which gives people the right to vote, but also from this Necessary and Proper Clause that specifically states that they have the power to carry out, to pass laws that ensure that this is enforced. Sorry, I'm checking the attendance. Okay, attendance is up, so please do post if you have not. Say that I'm here over in the chat. So key formal powers of Congress. They are the power of the purse and the power to make laws. That power to make law, the power to say, this is what the law is, okay? We're gonna talk about the power of the president in terms of executive orders and that authority that the president has. But understand that any power that the president has to execute executive orders is given to them specifically, given to the president specifically, in the laws that Congress has created. The second is that power of the purse. If Congress does not make a specific law, right? Maybe they can't, maybe there's gridlock, maybe there's a problem politically trying to pass a law that does a certain thing. Oftentimes, they can get around that representation function where maybe people are really paying attention to the specific wording of a law. And instead, they can earmark funds or they can specifically cut funding to make the president enforce the laws the way that they want it to be done. These are powers that are shared by both the House and the Senate. And in order to become a bill, a bill must be passed by both the House and the Senate, by a majority. And so that means more than 50%, right? There are 435 voting members of the House of Representatives. There are 100 voting members of the Senate, plus one, because the president of the Senate is the vice president. And so, actually, if you'll note, I just realized I did not update one of these slides, but we'll talk about that in a second. In terms of power, who has the power to do that? It's only a 51, it can be a 51 to 50 vote in the Senate, and it is a law, as long as it is passed in the same exact form as it was in the House. There are some formal differences. One, the House has the power specifically to initiate revenue bills. And there's a reason for that. Remember that one of the reasons for the Declaration of Independence, the War of Independence against Great Britain, was that the colonists felt that there should be no taxation without representation. Well, the House of Representatives is the body that most closely represents the people. They're elected every 2 years, and they are elected proportionate to the population. And as a result, they're the closest to the people. Therefore, they're the best representatives of the people. So they get to initiate tax bills, revenue bills. As a result, they tend to be experts on tax policy. And they serve, as I said, 2 year terms. There's 435 voting members. Now, if DC were made a state, or Puerto Rico was made a state, or Guam was made a state, or all three were made a state, right? If these things were to happen, then there would be an increase in the number of representatives, potentially, okay? Or it could just be set at 435, but it would be redistributed. Okay, that's another way that we can do it. Right now, it's set by law at 435, but it can expand under the Constitution. So constitutionally, that number is not set. Members of the House of Representatives tend to be specialists in areas. Like I said, pretty much all of them know about tax policy, but one of them may be an expert in agricultural issues. Another may be an expert in energy issues. Another may be an expert in banking issues. They tend to be specialists in their particular field. And they are, as I said, apportioned by population. They are the closest and most representative body at the federal government level. The Senate has a power of advise and consent. Advise and consent essentially means this. The Senate has the power to say whether that they approve the members of the president's cabinet, other key administration officials, high levels of the bureaucracy, but they also have to approve treaties by 2/3 vote. That's a tough thing to do. So they have a lot of power whenever it comes to the makeup of the executive. And also they have a lot more knowledge because they deal with treaties and things like that more than the House in foreign policy. So while members of the House tend to all be experts in tax policy, members of the Senate tend to have more expertise in foreign policy. They serve 6-year terms, which means that they are more insulated from the pressures of re-election, which means that they're much more open to negotiation. They do not have to turn around and raise money every second, especially during their first 2 or 3 years of their term. After that, re-election pressures come back in. There's only 100 of them, so they are all emperors and empresses of their domain. They are kings and queens. And senators have no equal, or as I should say, they have no one who is above them as far as senators are concerned. They tend to be generalists. They know a little bit about everything as opposed to specialists like in the House. And there are 2 for every state. So it's not equal. It's not an equal thing as far as population is concerned. This is something where absolutely, if you were to add DC, Guam, Puerto Rico, there would be 106 senators, even if the number of people in the House stayed the same. And so that would make a difference as well. It also means that the Senate tends to represent rural states more than it does urban states or more populous states. For example, California has more than 40 million people. They have 2 senators. Wyoming has 500,000 people. They have 2 senators. So Wyoming's power in the Senate and the people of Wyoming have more power than do the people of California as far as the Senate is concerned. There are also some differences due to internal rules. These are not rules that are written by the Constitution. These are not laws that have been made to govern it, but rather they are instead these internal rules that can change from Congress to Congress. But because of these internal rules, the House of Representatives tends to be more hierarchical. It tends to have a lot more power in the Speaker of the House because there's so many of them. There's also more party loyalty in the House than in the Senate. The House Rules Committee, also, which is a tool of the Speaker of the House, is able to put rules in place to either help the passage of bills that the party leadership likes or hinder the passage of those bills once they get to the floor. Now, the committee chair power is going to vary according to party. So for example, if Democrats are in control of the House of Representatives, which they are right now, then there is some insulation from the Democratic Party leadership if you have seniority and you have achieved a chairmanship, chairpersonship of a committee, okay? And so that means that your committee can look at bills and can negotiate and can discuss these sort of specialist areas, and you won't have very much interference from the leadership. Still some, right? But in the Republican Party, if the Republicans control the majority in the House, then there's no insulation from the leadership. You have to follow the party line in order to keep your chairmanship. So you cannot talk about any bills that are not on the leadership's agenda. And so there's less room for negotiation and less room for that specialization that we talked about. The Senate is much more egalitarian. All senators are equal. There's more negotiation within senators and more discussion. There's more gray. There's not the blue side and the red side. There's a little bit more purple in there. There's more talk. There's also unlimited debate in the Senate. The House Rules Committee limits debate. We can talk about this for this long. In the Senate, it's unlimited. And the only way you can end debate in the Senate is if people agree, everyone unanimous consent, right? Or there's a vote of cloture to end the filibuster. And that requires 60 people to vote. Now, I'm certain that you've heard of the filibuster, not just through your readings, but that it's in the news right now. There's a lot of talk about ending the filibuster or enforcing the filibuster. And let me explain to you that those are not necessarily opposites. Right now, if you are a senator and you oppose legislation, then you can send a note, a hold, to the majority leader saying, just so you know, if you bring this to the floor, I'm going to filibuster. And because that has been sent, it's a hold, and they will not look at that legislation. They will not even bring it to the floor for debate because they know that someone said that they're going to filibuster. And so this idea of enforcing the filibuster means that you can't do that. If you're going to filibuster, go on the floor, Mr. Smith. And you filibuster until you fall down or until somebody else takes over. Or until there's at that point, right, when you do fall over, a vote of cloture. A filibuster, it means that unlimited debate and you actually go and debate. Now, people don't necessarily debate the whole time. Sometimes they do talk about the merits and why they're opposed to a bill. And they usually at least introduce it that way. But other times they just go to the floor and they read Green Eggs and Ham. Or they go to the floor and they read the phone book, AAA, AAA Outfitters. AARP, right? And they read it. And so there's lots of things that you can do there, but it does require you to actually go to the floor. There's a lot of argument for ending the filibuster also, because understand the filibuster is not constitutional. It is a rule that was passed many years ago in the Senate to encourage negotiation and moderation. However, it also blocks legislation, especially when you have such a slim majority as the Democrats currently have. Democrats have 50, Republicans have 50, and there's a tiebreaker, the vice president. In the Senate, committee chairs have slightly more power than they do in the House, whether it's under Democrats or Republicans. They are completely insulated by seniority, and they can run their committees as they see fit. If a committee chair does not want something to come out of committee, it often does not in the Senate. If they want it to go fast, it comes out fast. So every 2 years, a new Congress is seated. When it is seated, then there is initially a vote on who the leaders are gonna be, who the Speaker of the House is gonna be, who the majority whip is gonna be, who the majority leader is gonna be in the Senate, who the minority leader is going to be, all of that, and an adoption of new rules. They do not have to keep the rules from before. There can be changes to those rules, and there is often a change between Democrats and Republicans. This is recent, but Republicans, as I said, tend to give much more power to the Speaker of the House than Democrats do. Democrats tend to share power in the House much more than do Republicans. Both houses of Congress are organized by party for both leadership and committee purposes. This is important because in committees, that means that there is a supermajority of whichever party is in control, has the majority. And this is to help make sure that legislation that the party supports gets out of committee or to block legislation that the party does not support. Now, again, committees can oftentimes and do send out bills that are not in line with the party leadership. But that doesn't mean that the majority of the party does not support them. So I have a poll for you. What should Congress be? And I have activated that poll. And so while you're doing the poll, I have a, James has a, is there a particular reason for what, James? Ask me.
The partisan difference between power to the Speaker of the House. That was what I was asking.
Sort of. Newt Gingrich, right? Remember I told you when we were talking about parties, how Newt Gingrich really built the party, Republican Party in the South during the 1980s. So when the Republican Party comes to power for the first time in 60 years in the House of Representatives in 1994, most of them are freshmen. Most of them have not been in Congress before. And so they give a lot of power to the Speaker of the House. And they do that because they want their agenda to go through, number one. But number two, because they don't really know what they're doing. Right. And so they're trusting it in that way. Now, obviously, that's 1994. That's no longer the case. Since that time, I think Democrats have had the House for 8 years during that time. So 20 of the years Republicans have had it, but they just haven't changed that rule. They tend to be more likely to follow that hierarchy and be OK with it. And part of that, too, also in 1994 is those who were Republicans who had been in power or who had been elected, but who had been in the minority during those years, really felt like they were kept out of things by the Democrats. And so they wanted this opportunity for the party to really dominate. And so it stayed that way as well. So Cindy asked, is there a way to drain the swamp? And the truth is I don't even know what you're saying, Cindy. This is kind of a random thing that was made up. Okay. And so it's unclear if you're talking about if members of the Congress are the swamp. The truth is there's an election every 2 years.
I'm referring to the Senate, and because they're so cozy and squishy and comfortable in their positions, is there, and they've been there for so long, is there a way to encourage term limits?
Anti-term limit for a number of reasons. One, it means that members of Congress, it means that people who are elected by the people do not have the power. It means interest groups have the power. And so with the great thing about elections is that you have the opportunity every 2 years or every 6 years to vote people out. And so that's how you drain the swamp, is you vote for somebody else, right? But understand that whenever you say drain the swamp, that was never a reference to Congress. That was always a reference to people who were experts in the bureaucracy and got there through merit. And the idea of draining the brain trust was part of that.
Okay.
And so it's kind of a, you know, it's kind of a strange way to look at it, right? Okay, so I'm now going to show you guys a quick
little— Thank you for clarifying, sorry.
No problem, I'm gonna show you guys a quick little documentary.
Your mind loves power.
It's great to learn.
Cause knowledge is power.
In Schoolhouse Rockin', the chip on the block of your favorite Schoolhouse Rock.
I'm just a bill.
You sure gotta climb a lot of steps to get to this Capitol building here in Washington. Well, I wonder who that sad little scrap of paper is.
I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill. Well, it's a long, long journey to the capital city. It's a long, long wait while I'm sitting in committee. But I know I'll be a law someday. At least I hope and pray that I will. But today I am still just a bill.
Gee, Bill, you certainly have a lot of patience and courage.
Well, I got this far. When I started, I wasn't even a bill. I was just an idea. Some folks back home decided they wanted a law passed, so they called their local congressman, and he said, "You're right, there ought to be a law." Then he sat down and wrote me out and introduced me to Congress, and I became a bill. And I'll remain a bill until they decide to make me a law. I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I got as far as Capitol Hill. Well, now I'm stuck in committee, and I'll sit here and wait while a few key congressmen discuss and debate whether they should let me be a law. How I hope and pray that they will, but today I am still just a bill.
Listen to those congressmen arguing. Is all that discussion and debate about you?
Yeah, I'm one of the lucky ones. Most bills never even get this far. I hope they decide to report on me favorably, otherwise I may die.
Die?
Yeah, die in committee. Oh, but it looks like I'm gonna live. Now I go to the House of Representatives and they vote on me.
If they vote yes, what happens?
Then I go to the Senate and the whole thing starts all over again.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And if they vote for me on Capitol Hill, well, then I'm off to the White House where I'll wait in a line with a lot of other bills for the president to sign. And if he signs me, then I'll be a law. How I hope and pray that he will. But today I am still just a bill.
You mean even if the whole Congress says you should be a law, the president can still say no?
Yes, that's called a veto. If the president vetoes me, I have to go back to Congress and they vote on me again, and by that time you're so old.
By that time, it's very unlikely that you become a law. It's not easy to become a law, is it?
No, but how I hope and pray that I will. But today, I am still just a bill.
He signed your bill, now you're a law.
Oh, yes!
All right, so back to our poll here. Let's see how we did. It says that, again, this is, I'll tell you what, this is an overwhelming amount. In my last class, I had 75% who said pragmatic and problem solving. In this class, 69%, 10% partisan and uncompromising, 6% hierarchical and leadership driven, and 15% reorganized completely. So that is quite a interesting outtake, both this morning and today. These are, just so you know, it always comes this way. I think number one usually wins, but not so handily, not by two thirds or three quarters. So you guys are really looking forward to that. So there's a stage by stage process. Chloe, you can just tell me what you think on that if you like, in the chat. There's a stage by stage process. It offers many opportunities for bills to fail. There are similar processes in both the House and the Senate, and committee is the first step. And so there's a roll of markup. You guys are working in your committees right now in your labs, and you're going to try to pass a bill. And so markup is where you take a bill, like I have written a bill and I have introduced it as a member of Congress. Now you guys are looking at it in committee and you're like, you know, this number is ridiculous. I want to change this. And you know what? This would work a lot better if we added this, or I don't like this. Let's pull this out. That's markup. Okay. And so that's the first step. Once it leaves committee in the House, the Rules Committee is going to create the rules for debate. And remember, the Rules Committee is completely controlled by the leadership. And so if the leadership really hates a bill, they can say, hey, let anybody debate this. Let the amendments be open. And then it can be sunk on the floor. It can die on the floor as well as in committee. But other times leadership may say, hey, I really like this. Let's make it tough to amend it so that it can pass, okay? Leadership has increasingly bypassed committees for the sake of efficiency. And I wanna talk to you guys about that, because remember, there are two functions of Congress. There's representation and there's governance, right? And a lot of times when we talk about those two things, we say representation is great because my voice is heard from my district. My member of Congress is able to get in there and argue things that I believe in, or maybe not even from my district, maybe just a member of Congress that is more in line with me ideologically. And so representation is important. But at the same time, we say, but sometimes maybe that makes it too difficult for us to actually govern, for us to pragmatically pass things and get things accomplished. And so maybe leadership bypassing committees, even if that meant I didn't get a real voice in it, we could only vote yes or no, we couldn't add things. Sometimes that's more efficient. And so when you guys think about what you want, think about that. I mean, for the most part, obviously, I think we would like a balance of those two things. We want Congress to govern, but we also want representation. But how do we do that? How do we balance? Once it goes to the floor, the House, it's going to be under the debate rules that the Rules Committee has created. The senators, it's unlimited debate in the Senate, unless there is a unanimous consent for no debate. If there's no UC, unanimous consent, then there's unlimited debate until there is a vote of cloture, 60 senators voting to end the debate. Once it is passed, it's been voted on by everyone in both houses. There's then a conference committee that meets with members of both the House and Senate to approve a bill that has exactly the same wording, exactly the same numbers, exactly the same periods and commas and so on. Once it passes both chambers in exactly the same form, the president can either sign it or veto it. We'll talk more about those sort of powers. But in general, if a president vetoes, the Congress can still overturn that. The Congress as a whole, remember, whose unwieldy 535 voting members with very distinct allegiances and loyalties, if 2/3 of them really believe in it, they can overturn that veto. We saw this under President Trump. We saw this several times under President George W. Bush. This one really stands out to me. Congress had worked for about 5 years to put together a water bill that everybody agreed on in terms of state authorization, what states could access, things like that. And President George W. Bush vetoed it. It was almost instantly, we're talking within a week, overturned by both chambers because they had worked on it so hard. And so when Congress has the strength to act as one, it is definitely the most powerful branch. Woodrow Wilson, who was president of the United States, before that, he was a history professor, but he was also one of the first political scientists, as we consider political scientists today. He studied and observed Congress, and then he reported on his findings. And so one of the things he said is Congress and committee is Congress at work. That means not members of Congress standing in front of a microphone, railing in front of an empty chamber, right? He's saying Congress and committee, where they're actually negotiating and trying to build a governing coalition, is Congress at work. And he's talking about the same sort of things we're seeing today. Now, today we watch it on C-SPAN. I know you guys are often glued there, but we could be watching it through the newspapers, right? This senator stood up and said these things, or reading it through the newspapers. Those are show horses versus workhorses. So there are different types of committees. There are standing committees, joint committees, conference committees, and special select committees. Standing and joint committees continue from one Congress to the next. They're ongoing, and they have large general policy areas, the Ways and Means Committee, the Foreign Relations Committee, the Agriculture Committee, okay, general policy. Conference committees only deal with a single bill. Remember, we just talked about that bill process. So they're just going to meet briefly. It's temporary. They're going to try to come up with a compromise on this bill, and that's going to be it. It's going to have members from both chambers. A special or select committee is only going to be meeting for a particular issue. Usually they're investigative, right? And so they may be investigating Major League Baseball or Watergate or Russian interference in elections or 9/11. So they tend to be put together for a particular purpose, and then they end, and they're only in one chamber at a time. Standing committees are chambers. Standing committees are only in one chamber as well. They only have members from one chamber, and they have subcommittees. So they really delegate all that business. Joint committees have members from both chambers, okay? And they usually deal with more sensitive things, military or intelligence. So the Joint Committee on Intelligence, so they're hearing ears only so that they can help make decisions and say, look, we can't tell you, but really this is something we need to vote in favor of. You know, we can't give you the details, but this is something we need to do. And so these are the types of committees that there is in Congress. I've been asked, are we going to talk about executive orders? And we are. We're going to talk about that a lot when we get to the presidency. But let me say this about executive orders. Congressional oversight ensures the executive branch is enforcing and interpreting laws the way Congress intended. Executive orders derive from authority that Congress has given the president under laws that they have made. So for example, they may say the president has the authority to determine what endangered species are. We're gonna name these 743, but the president has the authority to put things on the list or take things off the list according to a criteria, okay? And so the president can write an executive order that puts a bald eagle on the endangered species list or takes it off. So congressional oversight is going to make sure that the executive branch, the president and the committee and the bureaucracy below the president is actually enforcing and interpreting laws as Congress intended. So if they look at those executive orders and believe that the president is acting beyond his scope or her scope, then they can oversee that, and they can pass a law that says, this is not what we intended. We intended this. But understand that executive orders exist because Congress has delegated authority to the president to act in areas within specific parameters. Okay. Someone in my last class asked what I thought about excessive use of executive orders. And so, you know, I think excessive is, again, one of those things that is difficult to quantify, right? If Congress gave the authority to the president to do it and the president is doing it, then it's not excessive. Congress has the ability to stop that from happening by passing more specific legislation. And Congress does so, a lot of times using the power of the purse. Remember, another key power of Congress. They're going to cut funding, or they're going to specifically earmark funding when it thinks that the executive is using resources inconsistent with the law. The Vietnam War is a perfect example of this. The president said, well, troops are in the field. You didn't declare war, but you gave me the authority. And if there are troops in the field, then as commander in chief, which we'll talk about next week, I can do whatever I want to do. And Congress says, well, not if you don't have any money to do it. So we're going to cut funding in this way so that you cannot go further. And Congress is in charge of fielding the military. As a matter of fact, Congress could say, hey, you know what? No military is active duty any longer. Or only this small group, the Marines are always active duty, right? Only the Marines are active duty. Everyone else is on reserve. Congress passes that law, not the president. That's a power of Congress. Now, in Congress, political parties are really important. The majority party has the most members. This is the slide I did not correct, and I'm so sorry, okay? Currently, the Democrats in the House and Democrats in the Senate sort of have the most members. Democrats and Republicans are actually split in the Senate. It's 50-50. But Kamala Harris is the president of the Senate as a vice president, and so she's the deciding vote. The minority party has the second most members, and it's Republicans in the House. And as far as seating committees, it's Republicans in the Senate. This has a key role in how committees are set up, you know, what committees actually exist, how the chamber's organized, how many members from each party are in a committee. And then there are party caucuses in each chamber that also determine policy priorities. What is it that we want to accomplish while we're in power for these 2 years? There's a tremendous amount of party unity in Congress. And that goes back to when I talked about party in government 2 weeks ago, right? There's a lot of party unity in Congress. We can look as political scientists, this is something that we do, and count how often members of Congress vote with their own party. And it's 90% of the time. They are the strongest force within Congress. And this has only increased. It used to not be 90%. But since the 1990s, so for the last three decades, it has been very clearly Democrats vote this way, Republicans vote this way, and, you know, a few people go over. Parties were considered factions by the founders. And when we read about factions, when James Madison was writing about factions, he was concerned about their power to take over government. And so I want you to think about how significant partisanship is in the United States and whether that partisanship, whether that very strong party loyalty and party line voting is having an impact on our checks and balances. Is that impacting our ability of our institutions to work as they were intended, to check one another and be sure to govern, but also represent. Speaker of the House is Nancy Pelosi. She was elected by the House membership. She is the second most powerful official in Washington, D.C. The leadership, the Speaker's office is going to develop party issues, persuade party members, and the Speaker can always speak first during debate. They're often going to defer if this is not something that they're strongly behind. They can also recognize speakers during debate and is going to have a big influence on that House Rules Committee that we talked about. In the Senate, the majority party leader is the most powerful senator. That's Chuck Schumer. The vice president presides over the Senate, Kamala Harris, however, has power only to cast a tie-breaking vote. However, in this Senate, critical, super important. The Senate President pro tem is going to preside over the Senate if the vice president is not there, okay? And this is an honorary position held by the majority party's senior member. That said, that person is 1, 2, 3, 4 in line to succession to the presidency. The president, should something happen to the president, the vice president constitutionally, okay, becomes the president. If something should happen to both the president and the vice president, then the Speaker of the House, followed by the president pro tem of the Senate, not the majority leader. So it has still got some bite to that power. And that is all that I have for today. Do I have any questions?